Hey everyone, welcome to episode one of Real Talk, where we focus on everything real estate and lifestyle related. And above all, we always keep it real. I'm your host, Venetia Angus, your favorite local Ottawa real estate agent. And today I have a very special guest. He is a successful entrepreneur who started a construction company with his brother over 3 years ago. He's been investing in real estate for 8 years now and has taken it even further and is now working on bigger projects, and he's on his way to becoming a real estate developer. I would like to introduce none other than Alex Roy.
Say it again.
Say it again for the people on the back. Alex, mother flipping Roy.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, welcome. Thank you.
I'm glad to be here. This is very exciting. It's it's big. It feels amazing. I'm very happy for you.
Thank you.
It's a big step.
I know. I'm really excited, and I was so nervous. I'm still kind of nervous, but I have been practicing. That intro
is flawless.
It's flawless.
It was flawless.
It's flawless. And we need to just touch on the name, because it actually makes sense to have you as my first guest. You helped me come up with the abbreviation. Really? Or not the abbreviation, but what is it? What do you call that?
Yeah, abbreviation.
The abbreviation?
Yeah.
For my title, my logo. So I was like, hey, I'm going to start a podcast. I'm going to call it Real Talk. And out of nowhere, you're like, yeah, real estate and lifestyle. And I was like, man, you dumb. That doesn't make any sense. And you were like,
no.
Real estate and lifestyle. Yeah. Oh, yeah. And then it clicked and I was like, oh my gosh. Because that was literally the whole point of my podcast too, was real estate and lifestyle. So that was just...
Pulled it right out of your brain.
You did. It was just like in the subconscious, and you were just needed, like, yeah, just let me take that out for you.
A little extra sauce.
Yeah. I appreciate it. Yeah. But before we get started, I would like to start the podcast with a little prayer.
Okay.
And then we'll hop right into the questions.
For sure.
Okay. So, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you have made for us, and we thank you for bringing us together to have this conversation, and we pray that you direct the conversation, and whoever watches it, God, allow them to take one thing from it that they can apply to their lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, so let's get right into it. First off, people that have been on my YouTube channel before know who you are, but anyone that might be new, they don't know who you are.
Yeah.
So... tell the people what they want to know.
Well, I'm Alex Roy. Like you said, I have a construction company. I'm also the father of our great little son.
Yeah.
Mr. Kane Roy.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Okay, that's it. That's all you got for the people.
Straightforward. Well, I mean, hey, like I'm a entrepreneur, hard worker, always thinking ahead, thinking the next play, trying to make things happen.
Yeah, no, you're not lying. So, as the title kind of says, we're going to focus on real estate and lifestyle. But the first thing I want to get into is your journey to entrepreneurship. Okay. So when you and I first met, you were working for a company, still in construction. But what made you make that transition from working a 9-to-5, 7-to-3, whatever the case is, to being like, you know what, I'm a boss and I'm going to do what bosses do and own my own business?
Boss up, yeah. Well, to be honest with you... I've always been an entrepreneur in many ways. I've always kind of had the mentality to want to run my own ship, to be like, you know, in control of my own destiny. Because I've always wanted to, you know, be very wealthy, very, you know, in the millionaire status. That was kind of always my drive, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I've always had people tell me, oh yeah, you'll never make it. You can never do that. But I always encouraged that because I loved it. I was like, oh yeah, all right. I'll see you, you know, I'll salute you when I pass by in my, you know, whatever.
My Ford F-150.
Yeah, lightning. whatever it is, right? So, anyway, so I've always had that drive. Mm-hmm. So it was always in the back of my mind that one day I'm going to do this. So when I started working in trades, it was always just to kind of like learn what I needed to learn.
Yeah.
So that one day I could start a business and use those services that I learned and start it myself as an owner operator, and then eventually into just like owner managerial side of things, right? So
yeah,
that's kind of the transition that I'm in at the moment, actually. So
okay, and let's talk about your business a little bit. So initially, when you started your business, it was an eavesdrop company, and then you've now change that business to kind of just the old construction, especially anything exterior of a home or commercial building. Yeah. So what got you to transition from, you know, focusing on one specific thing to now just encompassing everything?
Like you said, when we first started, we specialized just in eavesdropping.
Yeah.
Because it was just a random thing. It was my brother had, met a contact where he was subcontracting from them, and they specialized in, gutter screens.
Mm-hmm.
So, he essentially was getting contracts from them, and then he said, hey, we should start a trough company.
Mm-hmm.
So, I said, sure, let's do it. So I started it. When I started it, it was 100% mostly trough and screen. That was 90% of our, 98-99% of our business was eave troughing. And then that's gutters for our American friends.
I keep on forgetting that they don't say they use different words than
eavesdrop. I say it to some people and they're like, what? What is that?
Yeah.
And I'm like, gutters. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Anyways, so So when we first started working, it was very straightforward. And then eventually I just started realizing that there's more money, the more things you can do. Right. Cause I started getting clients asking me, oh, do you do this? Do you do this? Do you do this?
Mm-hmm.
And then I realized that if I encompass more things that I could do in the business, then there's more money.
Yeah.
Right. So, then we just started, branching out. We started doing soffit, fascia, siding, some siding, windows, pretty much everything that I'd done in the past. I was just like, whatever, let me apply it to my own business.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Cause I thought of specializing at first, but then I just said, well, I can specialize, but just specialize on the exterior.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like essentially what we are now is an exterior envelope business where we do a lot of exterior envelope for residential and commercial, except roofing. But, that's usually part of the exterior envelope, but mm-hmm. I have so many contacts for roofers. trades guys. We always got a guy. So yeah, I have great contacts that do roofing. Mm-hmm. Shout out to SML. They do really good roofing jobs.
Shout out to you.
SML. It's Matt and Simon.
Shout out to you, Matt and Simon. Big dogs.
Yeah. So.
Okay, cool. So that's where your business has gone or transitioned. Mm-hmm. Now, let's talk about what it is to run a business. And when I say that, you know me, I'm big on social media. You're not so big on social media. Me being in the real estate game, even when I was in the fitness game, social media was a really big thing, right? In fitness, you got to show them the body, show them that, you are a product that people want.
Yeah.
Real estate, same thing. I'm showing that I am a real estate agent, a successful real estate agent, an educated real estate agent, and I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
So for me, social media can be a great way for me to get referrals. It can be a great way for me to just build business.
Yeah.
Now, for construction, would that be similar, or is social media not something that you need in order to build a business for you?
To be honest, so far, we haven't really used social media to its full effect.
Okay.
We are semi-present on social media, but as far as construction world, it's very much word of mouth and referral based.
Okay.
So like in the trades, whenever you do some, really good work for a client, your name spreads a lot more. The same way if you do bad work, right?
100%.
But good work is, it's harder and harder to find these days. There's a lot of people that are, fly-by-nighters who just do jobs to just kind of like do the job, get paid, and then get out of there, right?
Yeah. I know you told me what fly-by-nighters means, but
tell me again. Yeah, it means like somebody who doesn't do things the right way, who's just works in the darkness, right?
Okay.
Like just trying to get around doing good work They just want the money in and out and gone, right?
That's essentially
a fly-by-nighter. It's just like...
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So for you, you're saying social media is not necessarily a big thing for you. But
so far, no.
Okay. But let me ask, do you think it could be something that could be beneficial for your business if you were to take that seriously?
Possibly, yes. I would love to incorporate that in the future because it's a form of marketing. It's free marketing. It's 100%. Free advertisement. It's especially now the everybody's on their phone scrolling all the time, right? 100%. So if you can catch, you know, 2 seconds of a person's day, and then, you know, that may translate to, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars in business, right? In contracts.
Yeah.
So it's a possibility. I'd like to do it. I'm still kind of working my way into that. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? I'm a bit of an old head, so, you know. Like,
yeah. But you know what, though? You say you're an old head, but we're not too far off in age. And for us, we kind of got the cusp of, you know, that transition from... We're millennials. Yeah. We're millennials. At this point, our knees hurt.
Yeah.
Our elbows hurt.
Yeah, yeah.
Our backs hurt.
My knee hurts.
Yeah. Like, I'm almost 30, and I don't know what happened to my body. It's just not working.
Until you hit like 33, 34, then like...
Ra-da-da-da. I'm in the ghetto.
My toe is broken right now.
I know.
I broke my toe off the corner of the wall.
You stubbed your toe, a thing that everyone does. And I remember you were like, shit, my toe's broken. And I was like, man, your toe ain't broken, stop. And you were like, I'm pretty sure it's purple.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I looked at it, I'm like, yeah, shoot, it is kind of purple. Toe. I'm like, no, it's like a red. It's red.
Toe is like as purple as like the Hamburglar.
Oh my gosh.
Or no, wait, the Hamburglar.
I don't even know what that is. I just said, oh my gosh, to make it seem right.
Anyways, there's a McDonald's character that's purple.
Oh, with a little striped outfit.
That's the other guy. That's the guy I said, Hamburglar.
Oh, okay.
He's not purple.
Oh, okay. I thought he was purple.
The other one's purple.
Okay. Well, let's get back on track. Okay, so we were first talking before we got into millennials, broken knees, broken toes, broken everything. We were talking about how we were the transition from pretty much no
analog
technology.
Analog to digital.
Exactly. Like, and that for us is a blessing and a curse because, you know, we are able to disconnect from social media when we need to. I'm not going to say it's easy, but we are able to since we grew up without it.
Yeah.
However, I feel like we are still kind of behind on certain things.
Like the Gen Z kids.
Like Gen Zers are just making millions.
And they're on it.
Off of posting. Yeah. What are those videos called? ASMRs?
Whatever.
Like, you're telling me I could sit here and chew gum and I would make money? That's crazy.
Or God knows what else.
But they've unlocked it. And
figure it out.
For me, the reason why social media I think is important is I look at a lot of people, at least in my field, right, where Inezio Mazur, we've sat there and watched so many of his videos. The Less Than Stacks guy that I follow on social media, who's he's in Texas, and he's killing it. Like, he even said, he's like, majority of my business was built on social media.
Yeah.
I look at so many different people. Natasha, my friend Natasha Zurich, who literally built an entire business on her social media.
Yeah.
So, and these are people that are very successful.
Yeah.
So when I look at that, it's like, okay. And those are, and again, different categories. So it shows that social media can be a positive thing if used properly.
Exactly.
And I think that's where I'm still kind of slacking. I use it properly all the time.
I'll say the same thing. I'm slacking in that department.
Yeah.
There's a lot of room for improvement, but I'm willing to move forward, you know. And sometimes I might not know how to do certain things, but that's how I learned that the farther you get in the business, the more you realize that you got to delegate, right? You got to delegate certain things to get ahead, right?
Because
if not, you'll realize that, like, you know, your shoulders are only so broad. You can only handle so much without, you know, before you, like, crash out.
100%. No, I definitely agree. So I kind of want to switch gears a little bit. We're not getting into real estate yet, but I want to kind of focus more on family, the dating, because you and I, we started dating when you didn't have a business and you started the business. Then we literally had a family or started a family pretty quickly after that.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lot of transitions for both of us.
Mm-hmm.
I started real estate about a year after you started your business, but I already had my fitness business going, XYZ.
Mm-hmm.
So my first question for you was, how was it running a business while building a family and a home?
Hard. Extremely hard. It was a lot. It was, I've never done it before. It's the first time I ever done it. So to me, it was a lot to handle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people might not be, some people might just flow naturally into it. But for me, it was like everything was flipped upside down all at once. So it was like, you know, going from being a single guy with a 7 to 3 or 9 to 5, whatever.
Yeah.
Everything's pretty routine based, right? So it's like, and I'm a routine guy. I work well under routine. So it went from like, oh, okay, you know, go to work, go to the gym, go home, chill, do your thing, whatever. And then whatever else, you know, extracurricular stuff
that
you can
falls
do.
Within,
exactly. Till like now, okay, I bought a house, moved into it, started a new relationship. started a business.
Had a pitney literally
had a baby year right later. After. It's like, It was a lot. And yeah. it took a toll on me, it took a toll on you, it took a toll on everybody, right? So it's not easy. It's, don't do it like me. Like, do it one at a time. If you do it one at a time, it's probably a lot easier. If you decide, hey, I'm going to start a business, do that.
Yeah.
And then, you know, work somewhere else. But life happens, right? So, I mean, you just got to kind of roll with the punches. And that's kind of one of my mottos in life is improvise, adapt, overcome.
Yeah, I like that.
Right?
You should get that tatted. I don't know if you have any space.
I'm running out of room here.
But
so, yeah,
you should get that tatted, or I'll get it tatted.
I got my forehead, I guess. No,
don't do that.
I'm kidding.
You have your neck. Actually, no, don't do that.
I know, my neck is reserved.
Don't do that.
I have a reservation.
Oh, God. Is it a rose?
No, come on. No, I don't mean like the thing is reserved. It's reserved for a certain period of my life.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was going to be like, please don't get a rose.
No, it's after a certain amount.
Oh, okay.
A number in my head. Okay. Once I hit it.
Yeah, yeah.
Then
you'll get a neck tattoo. Yeah, why does that equate to a neck tattoo?
Because like I remember like my mom used to talk smack and be like,
yeah,
oh, don't get a neck tattoo. It's stupid. And I'd just be like, well, if I hit this number, then it's like, why'd you get a neck tattoo? Oh, because I hit this number.
Because I'm rich.
Exactly.
You can't tell me nothing.
Say something now. You know? What are you going to say? You're gonna be like, oh, shit. All right. Because now you can't say, oh, you'll never get a job. You'll never get this.
I got a job.
Already done.
I make that munyon.
Yeah, that munyon's already there.
So actually, let me ask you a question, because I know this is a little off topic.
Yeah.
No, not really. But I've seen a video where I remember this dude was like, I got my whole body tatted so no one would hire me. So I have to like start my own business.
Or
like,
yeah, sink or
like,
swim.
Literally. He's like, I made sure that I just did not look not presentable, but like that people were like, we can't have you at this business.
Yeah.
Now, I have a few tattoos in places, like my fingers and stuff, where I know some places are like, no, you know, you can't have that. But I mean, I guess times have changed now too, where tattoos are a little bit more acceptable.
Yeah.
But was that ever something that you thought about when you got all your tattoos? Were you ever like, I'm doing this so people look at me like, nah, I don't want him. And then you had to kind of start your own business.
I could say that. I could actually kind of use that. But no, that's
teeth.
I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to lie and say that that's the reason why.
Okay.
No, I don't even know. I just like tattoos. And then I just kind of, once you get one or two or three, then it's like you see yourself as a canvas and then you're like, F it. I'm going to do the whole thing. And then you just start going crazy, right?
I know. They're addictive.
Yeah, they're addictive. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't do drugs. I barely ever drink.
Yeah.
But I get
tatted. Dibble and dabble in some tattoos.
I get tatted. You know?
Yeah. It's like it's relaxing. I find it relaxing.
It's my therapy. Every time I do it, I'd always say, oh, it's my therapy. I'm going to do my therapy session.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is kind of messed
up. It's way more expensive, though.
Yeah, it's more expensive.
An but hour session is way something. Cheaper. I mean, hey. For anyone that does do therapy, though, you do leave with something if you apply it.
Yeah, you leave with a piece of yourself that you lost before.
Yeah, because we've done therapy.
You're like in the mirror, like this.
Yeah, you're like, this is for the time. You gave me flowers for the moonlight. Yeah. 100%.
I always make fun of people when they first get their tats or their sleeves.
Oh my gosh, I would be doing the dumbest poses. I'd be like,
you know, hi, how's it going? You look over here. And after a while, once you get like tatted for years, then you just forget you even have them.
No, 100%.
And then someone comes up to you like, oh, where'd you get tatted? And you're like, what? Oh, yeah. Don't worry about that.
But I think this also.
I mess with people too. Like, I'll be like, oh, I got these federal prison.
Oh, God. No. And I feel like for us too, being in the generation that we're in, and even the younger generation, they be taking things even like crazier.
Mm-hmm.
But I think for us, you know, our parents were like, oh, don't get tattoos, like you won't get a job and all this stuff. And I think a lot of people that are actually in our generation and the younger generation all have businesses or are doing something along those lines. You know, so like
I wouldn't say all, but like
a good chunk.
A good amount. I find that the entrepreneurial spirit is a little more present.
Yeah, 100%.
In our generation and the younger generation than it was in the past generation.
I agree. No, because I agree.
Before it was
very like go to school,
get a job, buy a house, get a pension,
start a family.
The pension is for some reason like the older generation.
That pension with a capital P.
Exactly.
It makes them happy.
To them, that's but I call that the golden handcuffs.
Oh, I like
golden handcuffs. Yeah,
why gold?
Because that's the appealing thing. gold is appealing, but at the same time, it locks you up.
Ooh.
So you can't leave.
Ooh. Right? Look at that word. Oh, look at that word. Okay. That's actually pretty.
Golden handcuffs. Yeah.
That's pretty clever. I know you never use that with nobody, though.
I swear to God. I use it all the time. Every time anybody talks to me, I'm like, yeah.
You got the golden handcuffs on, huh?
Especially when you work for the city or the government. We were in a government heavy town.
We are in a government heavy city.
There's a lot of people that they're like, I work for the city or, I work for the government.
Yeah.
And they, you know, to them, it's a flex. To me, it's like, okay, you just imprisoned yourself for the next 30 years.
But you know what, though? I don't know if you've ever read The Four Quadrants.
No.
So it's by, I don't know how to pronounce his name, the guy that did Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
Okay, I'm not going to try to say
his name. I'm not going to try to say his name either. Yeah, I'm not going to butcher that. So he did The Four Quadrants. I can't remember exactly what all the four quadrants are, but I know one's employee, one's investor, one's business owner, and one's self-employed, and one's something else. I can't remember all four.
Mm-hmm.
But he literally was like, society needs all four to survive. Like,
exactly.
We do.
Yeah.
You know, and there are people that are very comfortable in their positions, and they like that they have kind of that structure.
Yeah.
And we're not hating on anybody that has a 9-to-5, because at the end of the day, you're getting it how you know. And if that's your way of making money, that's your way of making money, and keep doing it if that's what you know and that's what makes you happy and comfortable. So that's one thing that we're gonna say, because ain't no one gonna come for our necks about that.
It's a comfort thing, right? So, like, some people, you know, when they start working at a job where, you know, hey, they're making X amount per hour,
mm-hmm.
and it's guaranteed. And they know that the longer they stay there, they're going to get, you know, incremental raises over 10, 20, 30 years, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. They get comfortable. They feel they love that, because they feel comfortable. They don't have to think. They don't have to do much. They just go to work, go home.
Yeah.
That's it. You know, plug in, clock out, right?
Exactly. And then it's like the rest of their time is for them. They can delegate that to other things.
Exactly. But I find that that's, you know, those people, that's how they're built, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's just how their mind operates. Whereas, like, entrepreneurs, our minds are, whenever I get in a situation like that, I always find myself, like, wanting more out of life. I'm always like, this is not what I'm supposed to be doing. Like, why am I here? Why am I doing this? I don't feel right. I never felt at home.
But,
and I'd always feel like I should be doing more. And I'd always, you know, go above and beyond and do side jobs and do this and do that, whatever I could, to just try to, like, advance at a faster pace.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, those people would never understand it, and I'd always be like, they'd be like, whoa, why are you working? It's after hours. Go home, relax, have a beer.
Yeah.
That wasn't me. I was always trying to climb, trying to create this, you know, trying to realize the vision that I had in my head, trying to manifest, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I have this destiny in my brain that I was like, I gotta get there, right? So
no, I agree. And I think for me, because I've always had a job. Like, anyone that's known me, I was a hustler in some way or form.
In, like,
whether
every
it was
field too.
100%. Yeah. I've done everything.
Every.
Like, I'm like a jack of all trades is a master of none, but a jack of all trades is better than a master of one or something like that. Mm-hmm. That was literally me. And
I'm glad you did the whole thing, because most people just...
Yeah, most people don't know that, so I'll repeat that for the people in the back. A jack of all trades is a master of none, but a jack of all trades is better than a master of one. Okay, and we'll get into what that means.
Something like that.
I might have sugarcoated a little bit, so it sounds better for me. I don't know. But for me, even when I worked at every job I've had, whether it was, you know, retail, whatever, I always had like a little side hustle going on.
Yeah.
Whether that was fitness, hair, what I even thought I was going to be a fashion designer. I would legit take people's clothes and like kind of fix it up and then be like, here you go, $10. Give me that. You know, so I've always been a producer, and I was actually, that's a lie, I was always a big consumer, but I also produced until I finally made the connection. I need to produce more than I consume, because at that point I'm literally just doing a rat race or rat. What is that saying?
Yeah, you're in the rat race.
In a rat race, yeah.
Yeah.
So I feel like a lot of people are still very consumer based.
We all are. We're just 100%. Trained to be that from the second we hit school, even before that, the second we're like exposed to any type of like media, we're just trained to be consumers.
Consumers. But you know what, for me, I think was my biggest, well, two of my biggest switches. One was my friend Natasha, when she was explaining stuff, and I actually bought her social media kit. Shout out to you, Natasha. If you don't know who that is, I will add her information in the description, because she actually put me on to game when building my business for fitness. Mm-hmm. And she was like, people don't like to feel left out.
Yeah.
And I was like, that is freaking crazy. That doesn't make no sense to me. And I was like, you know what, let me just try what she said. Because I was such a consumer girly. Like, you could post something on social media, I'm like, well, I'm going to get that. That's why I'm not on TikTok. Like, I am on TikTok, but I refuse to go. Because everyone that's like, oh, TikTok made me buy it. I'm like, girl, bye. I am not going to be spending my money on TikTok because I will go crazy. I will buy everything. Yeah. So she said that people don't want to be left out. And I didn't really understand what she meant by that. And then at one time, actually, we were together at this point when I started my waist trainer business. I did a thing where I did a pre-order, pre-sale, and, you know, it was great. And I started doing this thing where I'd put everyone's name that did a pre-order on the wall, put their name on the wall. I would actually have girls messaging me being like, how do I get my name on the wall? And I was like, this is crazy. Like, FOMO is a real thing for consumers. Like, the fear of missing out is a real thing. The new iPhone. People are waiting in line forever just to get an iPhone that is the same phone that we already have. But, like,
they just add a couple little things to it. Oh, here you go.
100%.
So the sides are flat now.
No, for real. Literally. And it's like this train that you don't want to miss. And I think as business owners... That's a really big thing for us to realize. Like, what is the product that we're trying to sell? That we're, or how are we serving people? What is it that we're trying to give to people in order to earn their business? So I feel like for a lot of people that are entrepreneurs or starting, that's a really big talking point. That if you once were a consumer, how can I switch my consumer mindset to a producer? If I'm buying all these things, that means that there's something definitely out there missing that I could be the one selling, which then when you're consuming, you're not really deep going into your pockets to buy these things, but you've made that money for it. Like, you're good. So for you, when did you have that switch? I know you've always been a hustler, but when did you have that switch where you were like, you know what, I'm a producer? I know you mentioned college at one point, Algonquin.
Yeah.
So when did you have that real switch where you're like, yeah, I'm a producer. I'm not a consumer, I'm a producer.
Yeah, so I took a course called Business Management and Entrepreneurship at Algonquin. A great course. And I had one class, there's a lot of filler courses, but there was one class that was called Entrepreneurship and Innovation. I'll always remember this. And it was a teacher that was there, I think his name was Chris Alves, something like that.
Hey, Chris.
What's up, Chris? anyways, he was really, really good because... I just remember the first day in class, he sat us all down, and then he, everybody, you know, came in, and I was older at the time. I was like 25, 26, something like that. And then the class had, you know, a bunch of 19-year-olds in it and whatever.
Yeah.
I'm there to learn because I paid my own way. So, like,
100%.
I'm not like these kids coming in off of, you know, mom and dad's.
Well, you don't know that because.
Whatever it is, I'm there to learn.
Not everybody came off of mom and dad.
Whatever it is, but.
I came off of OSAP, okay?
Whatever.
So, either way, that was my mom
and
dad.
I was paying my own way out of pocket. So, I was like, hey, I need to. I'm applying myself.
Yeah.
Anyways, I was sitting there, like, waiting for the class to start. And then he just had, like, a big. Picture of like an island destination, like looked like just a paradise beach, you know?
Yeah.
And it was empty. There was no businesses, no nothing. It was just like forest, trees, beaches, and stuff like that, right? So then, you know, everybody's there and they're looking at the picture and they're like, oh, it's so nice, you know? And he's like, okay. He's like, all right, guys, so what does everybody see here? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when you look at this picture? And everybody would just kind of look at it, and they're like, oh, swimming with this, oh, snorkeling, oh, flying here, going do this, do that, do that. And then in my head, I'm like, we're in a business class. Like, this is business. Like, what are you?
Yeah.
So then, like, he looks at me, and he's like, what do you think? I'm just like, scuba gear rentals.
And he's like, oh, yeah, that's money.
He looks at me like this. That guy's an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
And then, like... Everybody, and then you saw everybody's switches go off. Then he started, everyone started looking at him. He's like, you. And then they're like, zip line rentals or whatever.
People started
coming on the train and they're like, oh, business, right?
Yeah.
So then people started looking at a picture and spotting business ideas just from looking at a picture, right? I mean, like this picture, there's untapped potential in X, Y, Z fields, right? So I think I always had it in me, but it got fine-tuned there. And then after that, I was just like, no, I'm doing this.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he started explaining it how, like, you don't need to have a million things done before you start a business. Like him, he told me, like, he started the first business he started, he was a serial entrepreneur. He would build a business, build up a business till it's worth like 2-3 mil, sell the business, cash out, do another one.
Oh, wow.
In a completely different field.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so he's a legend.
And I actually just want to touch on one thing. When you brought up when you started college.
Yeah.
I think that's a really important thing, is because a lot of people think, you know, like, once you hit a certain age, oh, I'm too old to do this, I'm too old to start that.
Yeah.
And that's not true. Like, I had that same mentality because I started college, I think, 2 years later than everybody else, or a year later than everybody else. So it did delay me a bit, and I took some time off and all that stuff. So I kind of felt like, dang, like, I'm only graduating from university at this big old age. But then it's not the case, because everybody's timeline, one, is different. That's a big thing. But everyone's success can happen at any point. Like, you have people that haven't even gone to university and college, already millionaires. You have people that, you know, haven't or did go to college and they're still millionaires, but it just happened 4 years down the line.
That go to university in the top of their class and come out of school and have nothing,
and have, for real, 100%
crazy debt, and have a little 9-to-5, or, you know, a 9-to-5 job where they're not making any money.
It's, so for me, it's like, it's never too late to start something.
No.
So even if you are
thinking about learning something,
so if you are thinking about going back to school, like, don't hesitate because you feel like, okay, you're past that time, because you never are.
Past that time. I remember 100%. when I was in my class, in my accounting class of that same program, there was a lady in there that was like in her late 40s.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Late 40s in there.
Yeah.
Taking her just the accounting course, right?
Yeah.
Just so that she'd get better at her own accounting in her own business.
See, I love that. I love that.
That's
but
it.
There's
she was
always
just in the cut in the back doing her thing, didn't say nothing to nobody, and just came, did her job, did
exactly.
her life.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And now she's probably even further in her business because she took that opportunity to learn more, to apply it to her business. So I think that's a really important thing. And we actually got way off topic because we were talking about lifestyle and family. That's okay, because
we brought up real estate, which is
we haven't even brought up real estate.
So bring
that up. Yeah. We'll get there. Okay, let's get back into some of the stuff, because I think one big thing, and this is kind of a little bit different for us because of our relationship, but a conversation I've had with a lot of people that either own businesses or whatever the case is, they always said that dating has changed for them, like, their standards have changed for them, you know. And do you think that's something that is true? Do you think, you know, once you own a business, once your time is delegated to something else, do you think your standards for dating, or if you were to date, would that change?
I think so. I think, you know, I think when you have a lot on your plate, and that you're running a business and you're, you know, have a family or whatever it may be, dating becomes something that you just kind of have to try and fit in where it can. And like, you know, if you're single or in a relationship, it's two different things, right? So if you're single, then it's like you kind of fit it in where you can if you want.
Yeah.
But then when you're in a relationship, you can't really not do the dates, because I find if you don't do that and you neglect that, then it hurts the relationship, right?
So no, I agree. And I think for us, because we both have our own businesses, that was something that was tough for us, where it was like sometimes, like, because you're in construction, you still kind of have a set time, in a sense, where it's like, okay, I'll be done
daily,
by 4 or 5, whatever the case is. Well, for me, there'd be times I'd be working till like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, or whatever the case, you know? So I think that's something that we both experience, where we couldn't put each other first because it was like business. And both of our businesses are still, we've been in it, but they're still fairly new. We haven't been in the game for like 10, 15 years. So there's still always stuff that we're learning, having to adapt to, which will always take up so much time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
So we've gotten better, though. We've learned to kind of delegate more time
to
family, us, Kane, doing stuff together. So it is possible, but it is hard at the beginning, especially if you don't have those conversations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Having a conversation about stuff is very crucial. You got to talk about things for people to just have an understanding, a two-way understanding of any situation, right? Communication is big, right? And that's in the business world as well, right? Like, if you have a client, you have to communicate everything with your client.
Yeah.
So that they understand, you understand. Because there's times where I've done jobs for people, And it's like when I first would start to be like, oh, just a verbal communication of the scope of work.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end, they're just like, oh, can you do this, this, and this? And I'm like, yeah, but we didn't say that. They're like, oh, but I thought that was part of this. And you're like, okay, no.
I know.
So now I always write everything out and I say, here's the scope of work. Do you agree? Yes.
Yeah.
Sign. At the end of that, you pay me for that. And if you want something else, it's extras. Right?
No. That's important.
Yeah.
That's important. Communication is really important. Mm-hmm. And I prefer verbal, but if it's with clients and customers, of course, written is always better because things can always be misconstrued in situations. Like, we've all been there. I've been there. And it's just like, I ain't finna argue with you today.
You gotta cover yourself.
No, 100%. Talking about, you told me. No, I didn't.
Read the email. As per my email stated.
Oh, that's my favorite line to use. Everyone that knows me, everyone.
As per my text stated.
Literally. Because, like, we both grew up in, like, certain areas that were, you know, not like the hood, but we grew up in areas where it was like you had to have a lot of street smart, you know, like you had to be smart, you had to know how to maneuver, and that's probably why we're entrepreneurs now. But for us, there was no long talking. It was just like that's what we're doing.
Yeah.
And now to be in situations where we have to be so corporate with stuff, it is like
it's hard.
My favorite line is as per my email, because that already tells you, girl, if I gotta tell you again, we've been having a problem. That is literally what that for me, as per my email, means if I have to tell you again, like
pretty much,
girl.
Just the nice corporate way of saying it, right?
I love that. Everyone always tells me, how are you so corporate? I'm like, I've just learned to switch my words, but they mean the same thing.
That's the one thing I love about the trades, though, is that you don't have to be very corporate.
You don't have to be. Oh my God.
Unless you're dealing with, like, you know, higher end, you know, like, let's say a high end builder or like a client for a house. But most of the times when you're dealing with, you know, subs and things like that, there are other trades guys who are all rough around the edges.
Oh, you guys are all rough around the edges.
Yeah, most of us. Yeah.
No, most, all. So,
yeah.
Alex, I remember before real estate picked up for me, I mentioned I was a hustler. He got me into so many different, like random construction games, businesses. I don't know. Yep. Like I've done drywall, I've done like mud and tape.
Yeah,
I've done insulation. Like this man will literally be like, "Wanna learn?
You help me do some garage doors."
Garage doors, like when I tell you, I could pretty much build you a home damn near. I feel like I'm almost there, and that's why I said I'm a jack of all trades. Like I remember when I was doing insulation, I literally felt like one of the guys. Like I wanted to sag my pants. I was drinking coffee every morning. I don't even drink coffee like that. Like I just wanted to walk in there and be like, "Oh yeah, buddy. Yeah, today's a rough day, eh?" Like what? I got to a point where, like, I even told Alex, I'm like, I want to start smoking darts. Like, I want to start smoking cigarettes because I feel like it's just a part
the thing
of
I never
the
started.
Game.
Yeah.
Like, when I look at construction guys, I feel like it's like my hand needs to just be here while I look at my work.
Yeah,
like, so if you live in one of the new buildings on Carling, you're welcome because I insulated that out of those buildings for you. So you're going to stay warm. You're welcome. But it's just, it's funny. Like, I don't know why that's funny. But anyways. Back on topic. Every time we talk, I feel like, at least me, I'm like a little golden retriever.
You go off. You're like a goldfish.
What? Why a goldfish?
Because they have like a 3-second memory. That is.
My memory is better than that. Okay, so let's get into, I think I lost one of my cards. Let's get into real estate though, either way. Because, oh, here it is. I didn't lose it. I was just in the wrong spot. So let's get into real estate. For me, I always loved real estate. That was like something, I don't know, since I was a kid, real estate was always like a fascination for me. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if we ever played Monopoly together.
No.
Oh, okay. Cause I kicked butt in Monopoly. That's actually what got me being like, I'm gonna be a real estate agent. Not thinking, I didn't even know.
Monopoly mommy?
Oh my gosh. Monopoly mommy. I would literally make the craziest deals with people. Like, yeah, give me Boardwalk and you can land on all of mine for free. I'll give you half of my earnings on these ones. And people would be like, sick.
I did play it with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody was hating on you.
Everyone hated on me.
Because of you like,
I was good.
Crushing them in the past.
That's not my problem. That's just not my problem. No, I literally would, like, I would make crazy deals.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was like, holy crap. If I could do this in real life, I'm killing the game. Like, really, Monopoly is legit real estate.
You've always had, like, a fascination with, like, just like houses and like, you know, finishes and decor and things
that,
like that.
And just like,
which is
how,
like,
can I flip this?
Yeah, renovations, things like that. How to make things better, how to make it look, you know, worth more, things like that, things of that nature, right?
Yeah.
So,
But my,
I feel like it was a great fit for you when you decided to go down that road.
Oh, 100%. And I feel like I've actually been wanting to get into real estate for a long time, and things just kept on happening that pushed back me getting my license. But I honestly feel like it all worked out because I got so much more knowledge from other industries that I've been able to apply, like being a finance manager in the car industry, doing home insurance, like doing like installation and all this stuff, construction. Like it's all kind of paved my way for me to be into real estate. And I'm great at what I do. I'm gonna say that. But I want to know what motivated you to venture into real estate. So mine was Monopoly. What was your kind of catalyst that was like, now I'm getting into real estate? What happened for you?
Well, I mean, when you're in the trades, you work on a lot of houses. You work on a lot of properties in general, right? So when you see that, you see, and also just being an entrepreneur and money-driven, money-motivated. I've always been a very money-driven guy, money-motivated person. So always really good with my finances. So I find the more you get into finances and you realize that, you know, you can only make so much exchanging time for money, and then you know, you got to move past that, right? You got to move into something where you can now manage people that work for you, that, you know, exchange time for money, and then you can use that time that you've now bought back to do other things, like, you know, purchase properties, flip properties, whatever it may be, right? Because when you see how much more money you can make in properties, you know, then you realize, oh, okay, well, why wouldn't I spend more time trying to do this, right?
Yeah.
So I guess me just understanding the amount of money that is made in the real estate world, that I just kind of said, oh, okay, well, I'm going to kind of align myself with that. And then already being on the building side of it, I just said, well, you know what, let me kind of double down on that. So now I'm going to be part of the real estate world, but I have an advantage because of the building side. So I can, you know, do things at a fraction of a cost, or I know certain people that can get things done faster and cheaper and better than others, right? Or, or whatever it may be, right? So I guess that kind of, it was just kind of like a moment where you're just like, well, like, I obviously that's the next
it
move,
makes sense,
right?
It makes sense. You're already dealing with homes.
I'm already there. So it's like I had to go into it, right? So and then I just thought of different plays, and then would always kind of, you know, put it together, execute it, you know, cash out, and then see, okay, what's the next one, right? So that was just kind of like my understanding of it, and my decision to go down that road.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to check the time. Okay, yeah. So we still have like 17 minutes, so we're good. So my thing is... Yeah, there's a time there. Oh, I'm checking this time now. I'm making sure we good. So my thing for you, you've purchased properties in the past, okay? So me being in real estate, your first home, let's get into your first home, because I think this is really cool to kind of see how real estate has just evolved since then. So when did you purchase your first home?
2016.
Okay. So you purchased your first home in 2016. How much did you pay for your first? And tell us about your first home. Like, what was it, and how much did you pay?
It was, I bought it with an ex at the time, and it was $355,000, and that was a townhouse, 2,100 square foot townhouse.
Damn, that's huge for a townhome.
In Riverside South, made by HN Homes with a finished basement.
Not HN Homes now. Yeah, ooh, HN. That's that high quality.
HN, yeah.
Yeah.
They build a great house. I had no issues with them. Any issues I did have, they came and fixed it. Like,
yeah.
Like,
that's
I've never seen a builder where, even everybody that like I told about just certain things that happened, they'd be like, what? Like, what do you mean? Like, the first issue we had, I called them. They were there the next day.
Yeah.
I've never even heard of that. Like, most, some people I know, they tell their builder, like, a year and a half later, they show up. Oh, yeah.
No, I mean, we experienced that with the other home.
With the other building.
Where, and it was a beautiful home. Yeah. It was, like, a gorgeous home.
Yeah.
I found the finishes to be really nice, but we didn't really get the support when things didn't go right, which was unfortunate. But overall, like, it was a great
house.
It took,
like, 6 months.
I don't even think they fixed some of it before we moved.
Some of it, they had
some
to
of
fix
it you ended up fixing though.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Some of it I just got fed up and did it myself, right?
So. Yeah, and I'm more the type that's like, No, you paid for this. Yeah, yeah. And it's literally in the contract, and it's this and that. So this is why it's really important to always, you know, have someone that has your best interest. Exactly. Research your builders is really important too, and then know what you're getting into for sure.
Yeah. So 2016, 355, middle unit townhome. Yeah, 2,100 square feet, 9 foot ceilings. Granite countertops.
You and your 9 foot ceiling.
I know, I'm obsessed with granite.
You're like obsessed with 9 foot ceilings. Oh my god.
If it's not 9 feet,
gosh.
I'm like, this is a piece of shit.
Literally. And I'm 5'2", so everything for me, I'm like, oh my gosh, these are 8 feet. This is crazy.
But it's like once you've had it, you're like,
oh. You're like a fiend.
Yeah, no, it's you're just like a fiend just, for 9 feet. To me, it just gives the feel of a more high end home.
That's fair.
I feel like an 8 foot ceiling is just very old school and very like standard ceiling.
That's fair.
So I just once I had it, I was like, oh, I gotta have this again.
And you know what's crazy? Just to get into, and the reason I wanted you to bring that up, so you bought that in 2016, so 8 years later.
It's worth like almost $800,000 now, sevens.
Well, I know a lot of townhomes. It was a freehold too, right?
Freehold, yeah.
So a lot of freehold townhomes on average now are anywhere between, I would say...
650 to...
Six, yeah, exactly. 600s and upwards.
To eight.
So for a lot of people that are like, I never know when's the right time, baby, any time is the right time if you find... the right home.
Yeah.
And that just shows the value of homes will always go up. It's how long are you willing to wait for it to go up? And
sometimes it jumps,
it skyrockets, and then sometimes it takes a bit longer, but there's
usually it's always going to go up. Yeah.
Exactly. So it's like, why would you not want to put yourself in a position to make money?
Yeah.
Like, why would you not want to make money?
Yeah.
If you're renting, you're giving up money every month regardless.
Yeah.
You're going to be giving up the same money. And people look at it as, well, I want my dream home. Girl, you know you ain't buying no dream home at 27, 28. No, because life is always going to change.
Yeah, you got to look at a house as like another bank account.
Exactly. Like,
that's how I look at it.
Literally, it's really an investment. Don't look at it as, even if you're living in a cruddy home, you still own that home. And in 3 years, that home might have gone up in equity and you now have $30,000 in your pocket that you would have been giving for rent.
Plus, now you can also, because of like certain new laws, you can also like, you know, add a second dwelling in the house and then rent that out to like, you know, a family member or whatever, or somebody else.
No, 100%. No, 100%.
And then they could pay for majority of your bills, right?
So. No, for sure. Exactly. So you could even do that route and make it an investment if you don't want to live in it.
They call that house hacking.
House hacking.
Yeah, house hacking.
That H-A.
Yeah.
H-H. H-H. Sorry, I just got that hack. I don't know. HH, yeah. That HH. So my next question for you, I want to know, what are your future goals for real estate? So, you know, in your little intro, I said that.
So that was my first house. I had a second house.
Oh, shoot.
Over the second house.
Okay, well, it's because we don't got much time.
Okay, second house was 2020. I bought prior to COVID. Well, like just at the beginning of COVID once it hit.
But first, both of them are new builds.
Yeah, they're both new builds.
Okay.
Yeah. The second one, I didn't want to buy a new build. I wanted to buy like an older home, an older like bungalow. And then just like gut it, redo it high end, and then finish the basement, split it into a duplex, and then rent top and bottom, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then the realtor I was working on, I guess, had a deal with a builder that was in Castleman, and he basically was like, here, you know, why don't you try this guy? And then when I saw the houses, I was like, holy crap, these are underpriced.
Yeah.
So undervalued. So I was like, you're charging how much? So he had a single family home, 1,200 square feet, top floor, with like a good size yard. And it was $380 at the time.
Wow, that's crazy.
So I jumped on it. I was like, okay, yeah, 100%. Because they were a builder from Quebec, so they were used to Quebec prices. This was their first development in Ontario.
Ah, gotcha.
So then, yeah. So then anyways, I bought, you know, moved in. And then, finished the basement myself, tried to turn it into a duplex as well.
Yeah.
Not knowing that the township wasn't allowing duplex permits in that specific neighborhood. So, you know, do your research. 100%. If you ever do a build, don't take a builder's word for it. Don't take a real, sorry.
No, but it's
true.
Don't
take a realtor's word for it either, because they'll just tell you anything to get the deal done.
Not me. But one thing is,
a lot of the things they'll be like, oh yeah, that's possible in the future. Or
yeah, but things are always changing too, right? And I'm not going to say everyone's always up on their game with stuff for sure. Mm-hmm. So I always recommend, even if I do know everything, still do your own research. Because at the end of the day, you know exactly what it is that you want to do. I'm helping you find the home, and I'm going to, of course, direct you as best as I can. But if you're like, I want to do this very specific thing with the home.
Call the city. Call the township.
I will always get you the resources.
Speak to the building code specialist. Speak to the construction department.
Exactly.
They'll tell you exactly what you need to hear.
Exactly.
And that'll help you make your decision, right? If 100%. You have it in your mind, I want to do this. And your realtor's like, yeah, you might be able to. You probably. And the builder said the same thing. Call the township, the city. They'll tell you. So anyways, they didn't give a permit for the duplex. So what I ended up doing was just finishing the basement. And then that year, it just peaked out. It was in 2022.
Mm-hmm.
And then it just peaked out. And the houses, you know, skyrocketed in price that year. I'm sure you know.
Yeah.
And then I just sold when it kind of hit. It was that not the peak, but just a little bit after. So, like, I could have made more, but either way, I was still ahead. So, it was still a good investment.
Okay.
And, So, that was number two.
We have 7 minutes.
Okay, the future.
Yes.
I'm transitioning more into the building side of things.
Yeah.
Now, I'm more, financially independent, and I can now maneuver more into the, you know, development. Project development. So now I have a couple partners that I deal with, and we are kind of more venturing into, acquiring pieces of land, developing and either selling or using them for, you know, rental purposes or XYZ, right? So that's kind of the direction I'm in right now and going to be heading into deeper. And then, you know, the goal is to eventually have, you know, buy a monster plot and then, you know, build 50, 60, you know, 100 home developments.
Yeah.
That's the ideal goal, right?
So,
but that's down the line. That's, you know, not at the moment, but, you know,
that's
a couple
years.
That's
that big real estate developer energy. That's big energy.
That's exactly, yeah. So, but that's something that, you know, it requires a good team for that. You can't do that on your own.
100%.
You need to have, you know, all your bases covered when you go down that road. And that's kind of what I'm doing right now. Is I'm in, you know, smaller projects, not small projects, they're smaller than that, but
eventually
building
it's
the
monopoly.
Team. Yeah. You're just exactly monopoly, right?
You can't put a hotel on the property until you
right
put
away.
Three houses.
That's it,
so
right? So
you
gotta get
literally
the first, second, third, then
100%.
So that's kind of the direction I'm in, and it's going very well. And so hopefully the next time I'm on here, if you have me again,
of course.
It'll be a celebration. I might bring a bottle of wine to celebrate, or a bottle of champagne. We'll pop it, because I might come in with my neck tatted. Who knows?
Oh God, I'd actually be so angry if you did that. But anyways, so I want to get into last thing here: advice for aspiring entrepreneurs. So, what advice would you give to others that are looking to start their own business or venture into real estate?
Real estate or business overall.
Yeah, so someone that's looking, for instance, so for mine, someone that's looking to start their own business and also maybe venture into real estate, mine for your business would be to time block. I think it's really important to time block and to delegate your time.
Yep.
I think when I started my fitness business, that was one thing I jumped on very quickly. And Natasha was another, the person that told me that too. She's like, you never have to wait until you think you're making a certain amount of money to delegate your time. And the minute I started doing that, made a huge difference with social media, email marketing, all of that stuff. And I think for real estate, for me, would be if you're able to get into the market, get in the market. Don't wait for the best time. The best time is when you make it the right time.
Don't wait for the race and the
exactly
and the
because
housing prices.
You're always going to have a
fluctuates.
Reason. Exactly, you're always going to have
up.
A reason not
it
to do it.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I think those two would be mine. Jump in when you can into real estate and delegate your time if you're starting a business. What would it be for you?
Mine would be number one above all.
Mm-hmm.
You'll never be perfectly ready to start
100%.
A business. It's never there's never a perfect time. There's never a perfect amount of money. There's
I
never
agree.
A perfect anything to start it, because you learn more on the road than you do in preparation. You can research and try to, you know, look up a million things and try to prepare as much as you want. But in reality, if you start with, you know, the basics.
Yeah.
Along the road, you're going to learn so much, and it's going to be so much more valuable than watching it on a, you know, on a YouTube video or reading somebody's book and saying, oh yeah, well, this person said this. Everybody's journey is different. Every field is different. And then when you get into certain fields, you'll realize, oh, you get the lay of the land, so to speak. Right.
Yeah.
So that's my number one, is definitely, you know, shoot first. Mm-hmm. Like, go, just jump, make the leap.
Just do it.
Because that's the hardest part, is making the leap, because of the fear. You're going from the 9-to-5 comfort to, oh my God, I don't know if I can do this.
Yeah.
But that's where magic happens.
I was going to say, whenever you're scared, the minute you go past that, that's where you always hit the jackpot.
Your greatest accomplishment is just outside of your comfort zone.
100%.
Right? So 100%. That's my number one. And then number two, I would say money management.
Oh, yeah. You're big on that.
Yeah. I'm huge on that, because a lot of people, like, when you start making money and you make large sums of money, you learn respect for it. Or if you don't have the respect, you'll make it and blow it.
100%.
The respect level for money and the understanding of how to use it effectively, that's big. So if you have to watch videos, if you have to do anything for that, do it. Because learning how to manage money is very important in business, because money makes money, right? Mm-hmm. So money, you know, turning your brain from a consumer, somebody who just buys just to, you know, because you see a commercial, I want to look good, or I wanted this, or I wanted that, or, you know, people are selling you dreams, selling you feelings everywhere.
Yeah.
So the second you can see, like, you know, Neo in the Matrix, when he sees the numbers, and now he sees the beat, that's what you need to see. You need to see things for what they are, and then realize that you don't need all this stuff. But then when you make your money, use it. Because, you know, chunks of money is what's going to make you bigger money, right?
Facts.
Like, there's a million ways that other people can make money without, you know, using other people's money and stuff like that. But in reality, if you want to do it on your own, if you want to advance, you got to use your own money, right? So,
no, I love that.
So jump into it before you think you're ready.
Mm-hmm.
Get started.
Mm-hmm.
And then number two, money management. Figure out how to manage your money and how to use it effectively.
No, I like that. That's good. Shoot, I'm taking that one. That's mine. You can have mine.
You can have it. I'm curious. I'm going to keep doing it. So you can use it. You can have it.
Oh, I appreciate that.
It's not for me. That's the reason why I'm telling people. It's a gift for everybody, right?
You hear that? He just gifted you with some knowledge.
Use it.
That's pretty much it for us today.
All right.
We still got a little bit of time, but don't want to, you know. So we're going to end it there.
Yeah.
And I want to thank you so much, Alex, for taking the time to be on my podcast, especially episode one. That means a lot to me.
No problem.
I was definitely nervous, and I'm cool now. I'm good.
There's a comma. You're ready to smash like 50 videos out?
I don't know about that.
One a week?
One a week. We'll work our way up there. So first, again, thank you so much, Alex, for coming on my podcast.
No problem.
If you are new, please do not forget to like and comment on this video. I want you to say one thing that you've learned from this video in the comments that you are going to start applying to your life.
Yeah.
And if you don't already follow me, please make sure to subscribe to my channel and turn those notifications on so you do not miss the next episode or just anything that I post, because your girl's getting into it. And as I discussed everything real estate and lifestyle, and above that, I kept it real, and Alex kept it real.
Yep.
So with that being said, we are going to love you and leave you, and we will see you on the next episode.